Leon Leyson when he was young and before he came to America. And he's, of course, an incredible person, a survivor, as all of the survivors are, and it's been a real honor for me to drive him around today as he goes to different media appointments. And, you know, it's really been incredible to know him on that level, so it's been a real honor. So I don't really want to get into telling his life story because he's going to do that in his own way. You know, you're in for a real treat. And again, thank you all for coming. Without any further ado, Mr. Leon Leyson.
Oh. Thank you, and thank you all for coming. And I want to thank everybody that the rabbi thanked, because I can't remember anybody's name. So, ditto. and thanks for the wonderful introduction. Speaking of introductions, I once was introduced, somebody was going to introduce me and ask me what my bios are, you know, give me some. And since I'm not a public speaker, really, I told him I don't have any bios. Just tell him my name and tell him that I was a survivor of the Holocaust, and I had been teaching in the Los Angeles Unified School District for 39 years. And that should be enough, and I'll take it from there. So he got up and said, "This is Leon Leyson. He survived the Holocaust and 39 years of the LA Unified School District." That's right, yeah. I hope you didn't come here to hear some academic discussion about the Holocaust, because I'm not a Holocaust scholar. I didn't study the Holocaust. I just lived it. I grew up in it. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to tell you something about my experiences and that of my family, where I came from, how we ended up in Krakow, how we ended up on Schindler's List. I'll tell you something about my family back in my hometown and how we survived the war. It's sort of more or less that order. Sometimes it gets mixed up because one story that I tell triggers another story and it goes on. So sometimes my stories are not exactly the same because a lot of things happen at the same time, you know. So if you come back next time I'm here, you're probably going to hear something different. Maybe, you know. And so to start with, the first nine years of my life, I lived in a small town in Eastern Poland. Eastern Poland, where there were many, many towns like mine. My town was about a population, a total of maybe 2,000, half Jews, half non-Jews. And during my period of time for the 9 years there, things were quite calm. You know, the two nationalities, the Jews and non-Jews, kind of got along more or less. Every now and then there was some friction between, but nothing very serious. Now, in the my parents' days, they experienced some serious pogroms, as you know, in the eastern part of Europe. And so, but in my time, I lived a quite happy life in a little town where there was a river and we used to go swimming in it, and then we'd go ice skating on it in the wintertime, and it was just a nice, carefree life. There was a factory where my father worked. He was a tool and die maker in this town. There's only one factory there, and it moved its company to Krakow, and they asked him to transfer. So he is a young man in his 30s, going to a city like Krakow. It was an improvement, and it was a raise, and so he went to Krakow, and then later on brought his family. After he established himself, it took several years to do that. It's almost like going to a different country. When you go to a small town like Narewka, my hometown, to go to Krakow, which is a cosmopolitan city, used to be the capital of Poland, you know, it's a great privilege, you know. And so he was there for several years, as I said, and then eventually, when he established himself, he brought his family over. So in my family, there were four boys and a girl. There was, by name, Herschel, Zalig, actually Bezalel, and we called him Zalig. And then Aviva, my sister, in Poland she was called Pesha. And my brother David and I. So there were five children, four brothers and a sister. My oldest brother actually left Narevka a little bit before we did to join his father, and then the rest of us went. And so I was 9 years old when I came to Krakow, and to me it was like coming from a place like Narevka, which there's no running water, no public transportation, you know. If you want to go someplace, you have to walk, horses and wagons, you know, and stuff like that. A little bit like the, maybe the little shtetl you saw in Fiddler on the Roof, minus the Hollywood stuff, you know, that means it wasn't there. But something like that, only even smaller. So I was 9 years old, and we all came to Krakow to live. For me, it was like going to Disneyland. It was beautiful city. Everything was different. There was running water, and there was toilets, and there was inside plumbing, and big stores, and streetcars right down the middle of the street. I was enamored. You know, I was really fascinated by those things. They went by themselves, you know. And try to figure out how they work. And once I got a few friends, you know, after a few months, we would play games on these streetcars. We'd get on the, you know, they were a little bit like the ones in San Francisco, cable cars, you know, we have platforms on either end. So we'd get on the platform that was furthest away from the conductor who was selling the tickets. And they used to walk back and forth. And we'd go a few stops, and we'd get closer and closer, and then we'd get off and get on the other end and go another few stops and see how far we can go without paying. This kind of a life it was. A year later, Germany invaded Poland, and everything changed. Everything changed. Suddenly, I discovered that I was being treated differently. Because when they came, they began their campaign against the Jewish people right away, gradually. So anybody who thinks, well, you know, they're going to send everybody to the gas chambers, why didn't they run or go do something? None of that happened. It was all very gradual. So I'll give you some idea about how it really, you know, how it, from my point of view and what the adults were saying. Each time one of those restrictions was announced, discriminatory restriction, they were saying things like, well, you know, it's wartime, we can live with that, we're used to it, you know. The discrimination was not really a strange thing among Jews. We had a long history of it. And so each time something like this went down, they said, oh, we can live with that, the war is going to not last very long this time. They remembered World War I, when the Germans invaded Poland and stayed there for 4 years and didn't pick on any particular population and left. So my parents' age remember those days when the Germans came in World War I. And so they expected these Germans to be the same, with a little extra inconveniences. Like, for example, I found out that I was 10 years old by then, that I couldn't go to school because Jewish children were not allowed to go to public school. Well, you can imagine what I thought about that. No school, great. But not for long, not for very long. You know, even then I knew something was not right when all my friends, who Christian friends, would go off to work, to school, and come back, and I knew they were out there, and during free time they would play soccer and do things that children do. I was not allowed to do that. So for those of you who are school age, it's one thing not to want to go to school one day because you think it's a little cloudy and maybe you have a little tummy ache or something like that. You don't want to go to school. That's one thing. But to not to be allowed to go to school, that's a whole different thing. And I could tell that even at age 10. You don't have to be a genius to figure this out. I was not being treated the same. And the whole time this was happening, I couldn't remember doing anything wrong, you know. Suddenly I became a target. Suddenly I became, at 10 years old, I became an enemy of Germany. Germany could not be a great nation unless I was murdered, you know. I mean, it's impossible to talk about. But this was not obvious at the time, as I said. So I couldn't go to school. My favorite streetcars, weren't supposed to take public transportation. But at first, they had announced that Jews who take public transportation, like the streetcars, have to sit in the back. So they had a rope stretched in the middle of the streetcar. And now I couldn't play the same game because there was a rope in the middle. And the Jews had to sit in the back. It's a big sign on the side for Juden, for Nicht-Juden, for Jews, for non-Jews. In Polish, dla Żydów, dla nie-Żydów. And everybody would have stood that Jews sit in the back and non-Jews in the front. I must tell you this. It always reminds me, when I came to this country, after about 2 years, I was drafted in the army. It was during the Korean War, and I went for basic training. They sent me to first to Maryland and then to Atlanta, Georgia. So I was in Atlanta, Georgia, General Depot outside of Atlanta, doing basic training. So after a few weeks, they gave us passes to go into town. And so this time, you know, now this is way later, right? And now this is Private Leyson, you know, first class Private Leyson with brass shined up and belt buckle shined, and I'm getting ready to go to town. And, you know, the first 2 years that I was here, I didn't have a car. I used to just, all I did was go to school, go to work, go to school, go to work, try to get a better job, try to learn more English. And so I didn't have a car. I used to ride buses all the time. And I would, you know, on the way home, I would go to sleep in the back of the bus. And the bus driver would wake me up because he knew where I was supposed to get off. Say, Leon, you get off here. This is Melrose and Western. And so this is my routine. So this time I'm in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm going to Atlanta, get on this bus, and zoom, I go right back to the back of the bus and sit down. The bus took off for a little while, and it stopped. The bus driver came out and said to me, you can't sit here. This is reserved for blacks. You have to sit in the front. Tell you, it never fails to make me so emotional about this. It wasn't all that long that I was supposed to sit in the back and somebody else in the front. Now, I'm supposed to sit in the front and somebody else in the back. And it was such just a stupid thing in the first place. But it's a way to marginalize people. It's a way to put people down. And the Nazis knew how to do this really well. But I for the first few seconds after he told me that, I didn't even know what he was saying. He said, he's telling me I was supposed to sit in the front. I didn't say anything to him because he would not understand. And I never talked about my experiences in any way until 40 years later. So. But this is an experience that always reminds me of my streetcar days, you know, and I had to sit in the back. But again, you know, it doesn't make any difference where you sit. The bus or the streetcar gets to where you're going for everybody, whether you're sitting in the back or sitting in the front. It doesn't matter. But it's again, if you want to sit in the back, great, sit. But if you have to sit in the back, that's a whole different purpose for doing that. And the Nazis, as I said, continued to marginalize us and continued with this program separating us from the rest of the population. And little by little, they actually established a ghetto where Jews had to go live. They had to, you know, they had to remove them from their private homes and had to go live in a ghetto specified for Jews. Now, this is not a ghetto like the kind we know about. This is a ghetto that was surrounded by high walls. They built high walls all around a small area of Krakow and forced the Jews to live there, and the non-Jews had to move out. So just to give you an idea how crowded it was, the number of people that the number of people that moved in was three times as large as the ones that moved out. So we were jammed in. So besides being having lack of food and lack of provisions that they did not allow in, we had no room. We were just squeezed in. And of course, the Nazis enjoyed this. They had a good time doing that. Can you imagine? They built the walls around the ghetto, and it wasn't enough to just build 12-foot-high walls, but they had to, with a little German humor, build the walls so they looked like a whole series of grave markers side by side, all round it, like that, all around. And that was not by accident. This takes a lot of effort to build these rounded tops. It's a lot easier to just make it straight at the top, but they had to add a little bit of extra. They did a lot of that. My father, who came to Krakow because of his work, lost his job right away as soon as the Nazis came. Within a month or so, first he was arrested, then he came back, and arrested for nothing, actually. He came back when they let him out for no reason. He didn't have a job. But during that period, right after the invasion, a group of young officers came to Poland to make money. They distinguished themselves in the Nazi party. They're very valuable. They came to Poland, and as a reward, they were given factories and places that were confiscated from Jewish owners. And I want to tell you, they also confiscated plenty of non-Jewish property as well. They're not too shy about that. So one of those people who came to Poland to make money was a man by the name of Oskar Schindler. And he was given a factory to run, which happened to be right across the street from the factory where my father used to work, for which he came to Krakow in the first place. And when Schindler discovered that, he needed a craftsman like him, and he discovered my father didn't have a job, and so he hired him. So my father was one of the first Jews that Schindler hired. And eventually, as everybody knows, he hired more, and he didn't pay him. He didn't pay my father. But during the ghetto time, it was an advantage to have a job like Schindler's, because my father had a special permit. He could leave the ghetto to go to work. And while he was out there, he was able to make contact with all his old buddies from before the war, and he left some of his suits with them, and one of them, periodically asked them to trade it for food, and my father would smuggle food in his pockets. And this is how we lived in the ghetto for 2 years. My father would smuggle little pieces of food in his pockets, and my mother would cook something up, make magical, and then we survived like that. My memory of the ghetto is that I was hungry all the time, always hungry, and I was always frightened. The whole time I was frightened. Because the Nazis had already established the fact that we were not human, we're subhuman, human waste. And they treated us that way. So these Nazis who operated inside the ghetto would shoot people on the streets, beat people up on the streets if you were lucky, for nothing, for something. It didn't make any difference. So it was like living in a crazy place, it's like an insane asylum. And you never knew what to do. It was so random that no one could be smart enough to know how to survive. So my survival depended not on my being so smart, just my doing things that happened to be right. So I'm the luckiest human being on this planet, because those things I did were not because I planned them out and I said, oh, if I do this, I'll survive. I just happened to do this, and it happened to be right. And so after a while, Schindler was hiring more people, and my father asked him to add my brother, to this company. So my brother David, just the one next to me, he was 2 years older than I, is 2 years older. He too went out, and he too could bring something in his pockets every once in a while, you know. And you can't imagine what it's like to live without any provisions, or lack of provisions, and without human rights. That is something, you know, I've been in this country for a long time, and I know that when I hear myself saying that I didn't have human rights, I can't even understand it myself, you know? I mean, it's just like I'm talking about somebody else. Without human rights, you have no recourse about anything. You can't go complain about being mistreated or anything like that. It's absolutely impossible to imagine yourself that way. And so my whole instinct was, everything was pointed towards getting food. And I would run errands for people, I would carry stuff for them and do all kinds of things for, you know, a slice of bread. You know, when we were in the ghetto, to the Nazis, who accepted the ideology that we were all Jews living in the ghetto. The Jews lived in the ghetto. But in real life, if they looked at us with normal eyes, not Nazi eyes, they could see that in the ghetto, there were all these different people living. They were all different kinds of people, bright and not so bright, poor and richer and poorer and taller and shorter or whatever. It's just a group of people that lived there who were Jewish, not the Jews. So, you know, as an example, there was a family that lived up above us in the same building, and they were better off before the war, and they were a little better off in the ghetto too. So, you know, in my father's case, he was a craftsman. He earned a wonderful living and supported his family, and then had a little savings account in the Polish bank, and you can imagine what happened to that. It's gone, you know, it disappeared. So anyway, these people were a little bit better off, as I said, and the woman would occasionally, she'd see little guys like me running around the backyard. She'd ask me to run an errand, and then when I came back, she would call me upstairs to her room and take out a loaf of bread, which is something I could only dream about. You know, when I talked to my brother and sister who now live in Israel, and inevitably this conversation gets to this point, we always end up doing this. And so their dream was exactly the same as my dream. A loaf of bread, to be able to have as much of it as you like and have some left over. Anyway, she would take out a loaf of bread and cut off a big, nice, especially thick, and spread butter on it, especially thick, and give it to me, and I would take it, run downstairs and give it to my mother, and she would cut it into smaller slices, scrape the butter off, spread it on the other pieces, and we all shared. And that was a pretty good day. When you think of shortages, you think, you know, food is the worst thing, and it is. But there are other things that you need for living. In Poland, Poland gets cold in the winter. So in order to heat the room, you have to burn something. It's not like today, we can just turn a switch and turn on the air conditioning or turn on the heater or whatever. And so you have to burn something. My father used to bring little pieces of coal in his pockets from the factory. Factory used lots of coal for his enamel, for melting the enamel for their energy, and so he used to bring that in. That was a precious commodity. We had a German family who lived with us, a couple, who came from Germany, and they were expelled from Germany, and then they came to Krakow, and they ended up in the ghetto and lived with us, and we had to share our bedroom with them. And the man had, was an older man. I think he was probably in his 50s, now that I think back, you know. But at the time, I thought he was a pretty old guy. And he promised to take me to America after the war, because he had a son in the United States, and he said, after the war, take it to America. And he spoke German, of course, you know. And his greatest pleasure was to take a little piece of that coal and put it in the oven, and he stoked the stove and warm his hands. Had a pipe in his mouth, no tobacco, just a pipe. He was a wonderful gentleman, and he and his wife both did not survive the war. But he promised to bring me to the United States. Maybe he did. And so this is how we lived. And my father, after a while, of course, the Nazis built a concentration camp next to Krakow called Plaszów. Plaszów, some people call it Plaszów. It's called Plaszów in Polish. And that's where Amon Goethe, the commandant, if you saw the movie Schindler's List, shooting people from the balcony and all that, this brutal commandant. In the movie, it only shows this man doing that. But in real life, they were all doing this on a daily basis, every day. And so those people who worked in these companies, like Schindler's, were transferred to the camp. So my father and my brother went to live there. My sister went to live in another camp just like Schindler's. And she left the ghetto. And so that left my mother and me. And you're probably wondering what happened to my oldest brother. Of course, my oldest brother was 19 when the war began. And when the war began, he ran. And ran east and ended up with his grandparents on the Russian side. That part of Poland was occupied by the Soviet Union until 1941. In 1941, about the same time as the ghetto was created, the Nazis broke their agreement with the Soviet Union and invaded the rest of Eastern Europe. And behind the invading armies, they sent special troops. Their job was to find Jews who lived in small towns like mine and murder them. That's it. Now, I don't know how you can say that. Really, I say it, and it's like, did I really say that? And it's really something, you know, because it's something incomprehensible. These troops were assigned; they had one assignment: go find Jews in these towns and murder them. And so these battalions of soldiers roamed around the eastern Poland, right behind the invading armies. And one day they came through my hometown, which was originally under the Soviet occupation. You know, we lived in the Pale of Settlement. Anyway, they came through my hometown, surrounded it, drove the Jewish people out of their homes, down to the edge of the forest, murdered the men that day, same day. And the women and children were held in a barn for several more days, and they too were murdered. So as a result of that one action, of that one battalion of soldiers, everyone who was related to me in Poland died, except those of us who lived in Krakow at the time. That includes my oldest brother, who was there with his grandparents. And in the meantime, you know, in the ghetto, the Nazis did not, you know, eventually, after they roamed around for a year or so out there in eastern Poland and shooting people one at a time, it became a little bit too slow for the Nazis. After all, you know, the plan was to murder us all. And then just shooting people with these battalions of soldiers just seemed to be just too slow. So with good Nazi or German technology and science, they developed ways of murdering people en masse. Once those factories were built, he began to transport people out of the ghettos to these death camps. And you know, I don't mind telling you, when the rumor was that there was something going on and they're building these kind of strange places, and somebody said that those were death camps and gas chambers, and we didn't believe that. No one in his right mind could have believed that a nation of civilized in the middle of Europe, which is with wonderful universities and professors and scholars, doctors and lawyers and composers who composed songs about love and among all humankind, you know, alle Menschen werden Brüder, you know, right? So it was just unbelievable. And so the first transport that was formed, I think you've seen one depicted in the movie, but that was one of them. There were several transports, but the first one that was formed, which was not shown in the movie, the Nazis announced that there was going to be a train out there in the railroad station, and anybody who wanted to can get on it. And then they'll be taken to the countryside, and where they would have jobs, fresh air. And at the same time, they would alleviate the congestion in the ghetto. What a good idea. And so at the time, a lot of people went voluntarily. Who wouldn't want to leave the ghetto, this place that is worse than being in hell, and go out there in the countryside and get work, and, you know, they didn't mind working. But little by little, the word came back that these things really are happening. So by the second transport and the third, then we were pretty well agreed that this is what they really were doing. And so with that, Nazis played games. At first, they stamped our ID cards. Those who were exempted from the transport had an ID card stamped. You had to go to the office and have an ID card stamped. And so my father went to the office, had his stamped. So that for that transport, for that first one, we were exempted. But then after the second, third, and you know, the Nazis really didn't care about all this stuff. They were just playing games. They just needed to fill the factories, and they have to send this material, you know, the Jews, you know, to fill them up. And so in the movie, you saw one of those transports. And how many of you have seen the movie? So many of you have. So that was an actual event. By the way, most of the events depicted in the movie are actual events. So this particular transport was an actual event. And so Schindler, as you remember, found out that his accountant was taken. By that time, he had quite a few people working for him, and the accountant didn't have his blue slip. They gave blue slips out. They attached it to your ID card. So he kept all these, played these games. And so he was taken, rounded up and taken on this transport. Schindler found out about it, went to the railroad station to rescue his accountant. And so you remember they went up and down the railroad cars, looked into each one, they called his name, Stern. Finally, Schindler found Stern, got him off the train, and Stern survived the war with us at the end. But what you didn't see, and a movie can't show you everything. A movie is just really a movie, regardless of how accurate the events are depicted. You know, it's a movie. It's a three-hour movie. It makes you uncomfortable to sit 3 hours. But the real thing lasted a lot longer than that. You know? So, what you didn't see in this particular transport, this same one, when Schindler was looking for his accountant, he saw my then second oldest brother, who was then with us in the ghetto. You know what happened to my oldest brother, but the second oldest. He was taken on this particular transport. When Schindler saw him, he offered to get him off the train. And my brother declined to get off the train because he was there with his girlfriend. And Schindler couldn't get her off. So my brother decided that he would stay with her. They both ended up at the end of the line in Belzec, a death camp, where they both died. I just want you to know that as hard as it is for me to tell about my brother, he really was my big brother. My oldest brother escaped in the, you know, in the early 39, and I didn't know him all that well, you know, and he was that much, you know, 10 years older than I, so we didn't have a whole lot. But this one was my big brother. When I was 12, he was 17, you know. And so I find it very hard to talk about, but I want you to know that when we talk about numbers, the number of people that the Nazis murdered, but they didn't kill numbers. They killed people. Individual, somebody's brother, somebody's uncle and aunt, somebody's grandparent, somebody, you know, people without regard to anything. So if you want to contemplate about the enormous event that took place during that time, what the Nazi had done, it's more important to contemplate the fact that they murdered individuals. And I think this, speaking of that, maybe that's why the movie Schindler's List made such an impression, a better, you know, a bigger impression than all the previous movies about the Holocaust, which there were many. In Schindler's List, what you saw was individual people. It didn't focus so much on the atrocities, on thousands and thousands of bodies being shoved into a ditch and all these kind of things, even though you saw some atrocities, but they were something that was understood, you know. But in the meantime, you saw individuals, families, people by their names, and you saw somebody like Schindler. It's a very important thing to know about Oskar Schindler, the man. In the midst of this government policy to murder all the Jews, there was a Schindler who decided to not follow the Nazi ideology. And it, you know, if you try to, you know, people try to figure out why he did it and all these things. There's no need for that. There's no need to find out why he did it. He did it because he's a decent human being. He had the opportunity to do it, and that's what he did. Anything, you know, in the movie they show maybe a little bit of conflict between when he, by exactly when he switched from being a Nazi to a non-Nazi or something, Nazi to a rescuer. Now that didn't really happen. He was a rescuer all along. A different kind of human being. You know, to do that when the norm, the government policy was to murder Jews. To save Jews was against the law. Imagine that. And punishable with the Nazis, everything is strict possible punishment, you know. And he did get into trouble on many occasions, and he got arrested, and he was quite a fast talker, and he had, by that time, had quite a bit of money, so he talked himself out of it, and bribed people. And this is how he was able to accomplish what he did. He did, you know, he befriended a lot of these Nazi officials, and eventually bribed them, and he was able to accomplish what he was going to do. But not because he somehow saw the light and decided to do this. You know, if I brought somebody like Schindler into this room, and somebody, a Nazi who accepted the ideology that, some, you know, they were the Übermensch, you know, master race, and stood them side by side alongside of me, you would recognize immediately who was the Nazi and who was not. A Nazi looking him in the eye, and you could see nothing, you know, blank. There's no soul, nothing in between the eyes. With Schindler, it's altogether different. You know, when he used to, he had a habit of coming down to the factory floor after these visitors, after his guests left, and visit with us, you know, stop and talk to us. You know, stop and talk to me. And, you know, he looked me right in the eye, spoke in complete sentences, unlike the Nazis, who didn't speak to us in complete sentences. They only barked orders, single command, single word commands, Haus, schnell, los, this, you know, stuff like that. Schindler would stop, talk to me, ask me how I'm doing, and, you know, he was kind of a little bit amused, maybe because I stood on the box. I was too little to reach the controls really well, so I stood on a box about 8 inches high, and I was running this machine, and he would ask me how I was doing, and then he'd go on, talk to my brother, who worked on another machine just like mine, talk to my father. Sometimes he'd leave something on my father's workbench, so, you know, like half a pack of cigarettes. In those days, it was like, you know, an exchange. You could buy a, you know, slice of bread for a cigarette. Very, very valuable. And sometimes when he spoke to me, and the next day I would go to get a ration of food, I'd find out that Schindler left word that I should receive 2 rations. Yeah. Just think, you know. He'd been partying all night, and he saw this kid, and then the next day he had to go see the person who handed out the rations in order to 2 rations. He did that because that's the kind of human being he was. By the way, my journey to Schindler's company was long, and I didn't get to Schindler's company until I had been in the ghetto for 2 years. And then another year, almost another year, in a splash of camp. Then I finally made it to Schindler's company. But it was a long and treacherous road. When the ghetto was being closed because they had transferred so many people out and sent them to the gas chambers, my mother and I were the only ones left in the ghetto by that time. And they ordered everybody to line up according to the factories where we worked. We all worked in different factories that they ran in the ghetto. And then they would escort us one group at a time out of the ghetto into the Plaszów camp. And when my group was ready to leave, I worked in a brush factory by that time. I was a brush maker. I got to where just about where the gate was. That's all right. This happens all the time. Unfortunately. It's okay. When I got to where about the gate was, I was told I was pulled out, and the guard said, "You come later." And I knew that was not too good. So we went back to join the other group of kids who were not allowed out either, my friends, and huddled up trying to figure out what to do. And they decided they were going to go hide. That's because we'd hidden once before and we escaped one of the transports. So they thought they were going to do that again. And I decided not to do that. And not because I was so smart, because I saw my mother leave with her group right in front of me. And I was the young boy, just, yeah, that's good, thank you. And I wanted to go where my parents were, you know, just a normal thing. And it was just the right thing to do, because those people who went hiding were then caught, murdered, and they did not survive the war. None of my friends survived the war. The idea of going to hide was pretty good, because we'd hidden once before and escaped one of the transports. But this time around, it was not the right thing. And I decided I would join another group, and I joined several other groups. I got pulled out again once, twice, and then the guard wasn't looking one time, and I made it out of the ghetto into the Plaszów camp. It was just like if the the camp, the ghetto was bad. The camp was just unbelievably hard to explain. It was really the end of the world. And I knew when I got in there, you know, I was always skeptical about surviving. But when I came to that Plashov camp, I knew this was going to be the end. It's out of there. Nobody's going to leave alive. You know, dogs barking, barracks as far as the eye could see, nothing familiar. And so I spent the rest of the year in this camp. And then Schindler was, you know, he was able to persuade the authorities to let him build a sub-camp near his factory, because he was able to persuade them, because then now these people who worked for him had to travel from the camp, be escorted out, and then back again. And so with a little bribes and a few other things, you know, I have some water over here too. He was able to persuade them, and he actually built a sub-camp. My father and my brother went to live there. And then as he was adding more people to his workforce, at one point, he's had his own sub-camp next to the factory. And so my father asked him to add my mother and me to the list. And so there was a little mini list, about 30 people. They were going to be transferred from Plashov, which was like the end of the world, to Schindler's company. And this is how I made it to Schindler's company. But not directly, never smoothly. Because a day or so before we were supposed to be escorted out, I discovered that my name was crossed off the list. And so by that time I went back to work in this brush factory, and I couldn't find out why they crossed my name off. But I went to see them off when they were leaving. They were gathering up the people who were going to leave in front of the gate. So I slipped away from my work in a brush factory, went to see my mother leaving. And I don't know exactly what happened, because normally somebody walking along the camp with aimlessly would be caught and gotten some serious trouble, but nobody saw me, nobody stopped me. Then I was close to them, I could hear them talk. And the last few steps I took, I can't even remember, but I was right in front of this officer who was big, brutal Nazi officer who was in charge of the group, and told him my name, told him that I was on the list and somebody crossed my name off. Then I said to him, can you imagine, I'm talking to this Nazi who doesn't even think I'm a human being. I'm trying to tell him about my family, you know, like, you know, my mother's on the list and she's in this group. And then I said, and my father and my brother are already there. Even then, I thought to myself, yeah, that is so stupid, you shouldn't have said that. You know, there's no telling what he might do. But what he did was, he looked at the list and he looked at me and he ordered me into this group. Just, he didn't say anything, he just barked, you know, and pointed. So I jumped in the group and tried to make myself smaller than I ever was, and it seemed like it was standing there for a long time, but it probably wasn't, because there was something going on and I was afraid he might change his mind. But this is how I made it into this company. And that's where I had a few months of respite, you know, from the constant harassment and constant danger of being murdered. And my experience with Schindler was extraordinary. You need to know that this man was different. He was different. As I said, if I brought him here, you could recognize him right away. That reminds me that there was a lot of talk about people not resisting. You know, the Jews didn't resist. They walked on the gas chambers and without resisting and all that. That's nonsense. Everybody resisted in any way they could. And so we could resist by doing what we could to keep our humanity while they were trying to take our humanity away. And that's resistance. Anything that we did to keep our humanity was resistance. And so, as I said earlier, in the ghetto there were all kinds of talented people. There were professors and lawyers and people who were in the profession, in the arts, and we sang songs, we told jokes, we recited poetry. I went to Haider. Can you imagine that? In a real dark little room there behind the building that, you know, we did all those things behind their backs. And that's the part that they couldn't kill. They could kill us. They killed a lot of us. But they couldn't kill our spirit. So, speaking of jokes, I should probably tell you one so you can give you a break from all this misery. My favorite jokes was the Nazi who was been shooting Jews all this time in Eastern Europe and all over, you know, with his pistol, and got a little boring. You know, there was no more fun. You know, he was not enjoying it very much anymore, and so he had this Jew who was going to shoot, and so he thought he was going to have a little fun, and so he told him that if the Jew could guess which one of his eyes was made out of glass, he would let him live. And so, this was, you know, and then he told them about how this eye was made by this terrific German technician, and nobody could guess the real eye, the glass eye, from the real eye. But if he could guess, he'd let him live. He's going to stop here soon. And so the Jew looked in his eye, he had no choice, and finally, he looked at one, and finally pointed to one. He said, "This one." And the Nazi was astounded. Of course, it was the right one. It was glass. And so he wanted to know how he had guessed it, because nobody else guessed before which one was the glass eye. So the Jew said, "You know, I looked into each one of your eyes, and in one of them, I saw a little glimmer of humanity. I knew that was glass." You got to do something to keep up your spirits, you know. This is actually not part of the act. This is a little extra. You don't. You should know this. That I'm getting a bloody nose while I'm standing like that. It's something little special.
You want to sit down? Would that be better? No,
I don't think so. I don't think so. If it doesn't. Bother you too much, I'm doing this. And if I don't have a bloody nose, I have a nose running anyway, so it doesn't matter. Eventually, the war was going badly for the Germans, and the Russians were going to be in Krakow soon, and so people like Schindler, who came to Poland to make their fortune, just grabbed their money and ran and sent their employees back to the camp, the main camp, where most of them did not survive the war. Well, Schindler decided he was going to do something entirely different. He was going to dismantle the factory, ship it to Czechoslovakia, and then bring his employees with him, which is something I never believed he would be able to accomplish. You know, I was skeptical all along, but this was way over the top. But as everybody knows now that he did, it's no mystery. And those other people, they, as I said, send their people back. My sister, who worked in another company like Schindler's called Kabelwerk, they sent her back to the main camp. She was in this concentration camp. When Schindler was still transferring after he transferred the workers, the factory to Czechoslovakia, we all went back to Plaszów, and then from there we were shipped to his company. So in the meantime, my father asked Schindler to add my sister who was never on Schindler's list in the first place, who was sent back from another company. He added her to the list, and she too ended up in on Schindler's list. Yeah. As you know, that from the movie, that those women were diverted from directly to go to Schindler's company through Auschwitz. So they ended up in Auschwitz. So in Auschwitz, when people came in, there was a man standing there who decided who should live and who should die. In those, it's called a selection. And so when my mother and my sister what a wimp.
Actually, if you put it on the back of your neck, you know it'll stop.
I heard that too, yeah. And give it enough time, it'll stop too. Oh, yeah. That's not the worst thing that ever happened to me. I'm sorry. Okay. So the women were then shipped to Auschwitz, as you know from the movie. And as my mother and my sister approached this man who was doing the selection, my mother was sent to the left to die, and my sister to die to live. And when Schindler discovered that women on his list were being sent to his factory, he went and spent more of his money, bribed more people, and insisted that all the women on his list be sent to him, because they're all these experts. You know, like my mother, who was a cleaning lady, you know, she was an expert. And so, at that point, my mother was taken out of the barracks where she was awaiting the gas chamber and joined the women who were sent to Schindler's company. I'm only telling you this because this happened in 1944. In 1944, my mother was 42. Imagine a person 42 is already not worth living. So some of your children, you know, you go home and ask your grandparents, is 42 is old. And I know a few people here that don't need to go home and ask the grandparents. Imagine that. At 42, she was already worn out. She was beaten up. She had a hard life. You know, when I think about the kind of life she had, at the same time that we had the same experience, her experience was so much worse. She was a mother. She was a parent. She lost her two oldest children. She didn't know at the time that the rest of the family was gone. And she was beaten up in the camps where, you know, she picked up something. She was working on a barracks, picked up a board, and the guard didn't like the way she did it, and hit her in the face and broke her eardrum, so she had a broken eardrum the rest of her life. And she was just beaten up. You know, I wasn't this smart until I was a parent, and my children were 12 and 14, and I looked at them, and I thought to myself, you know, If I were had to face something like what they had to face, I don't think I could have made it. It must have been really strong people to be able to live through it. You know, when I first made it into this camp, and my parents found out that I had gotten through from the ghetto to the Plaszow camp, my mother was already there, of course, and. At that time I was, you know, you couldn't tell whether I was male or female, you know, I was just kind of raggedy looking little kid. And the camp was not completed yet, so the division between the men and the women was not quite solid, you know, as it was later. And so I slipped through the wires and went to see my mother. And of course she was elated, you know, she saw me and she said, oh my God, great. And then immediately started pushing me out the door, and, you know, get back, because you're going to get in trouble and everything. And so but before I got out the door, she reached out behind her, the rags that she was sleeping on, and pulled out a little piece of bread about as big as a walnut, all dried up, and gave it to me. It's the best she could do. That's probably the last thing she had. So she had a hard life, and so did my father. And of course, we all survived, as you know, on Schindler's List. They ended up in Schindler's company. And you know, if the war had lasted much longer, none of us would have survived even on Schindler's List. We were all running out of steam, all running out of energy. You know, after 5.5 years of this persecution and constant harassment and lack of food, you know, we, you know, bought the pyramid, the food pyramid. Nothing like that. It was ridiculous, you know. And so, eventually, as you know, we were all transferred to Schindler's company, and the war was going to be over soon. And Schindler, before he left, of course, he didn't want to be caught by the Russians, because we were going to be liberated by the Russians. And so he was escorted with some of our people to the Allied side. And as you know from the movie, that he was given a ring that somebody made from a gold tooth, gave it to him, and inscribed it inside with a Talmudic saying, which says that he who saves one life saves the world entire. And that fits Schindler perfectly. He saved 1,200 people, but he saved a lot more than that. He saved an enormous number of people when you think about the future generations to come, yet to come. I'm a married man. I have a son and a daughter. The daughter has married. She has 4 boys. You know, and they will have children and so on. And my son is recently married, so we're waiting. Yeah, that's right. And so when you think about it, he was, in my mind, he was a genuine hero. Because he had nothing personal to gain except his self-respect in doing what he did. It, on the contrary, he had a lot to lose, which he did. And so for that, I have a definition of a hero that I borrowed from Joseph Campbell, The Power of Myth. I heard him interviewed many years ago, and he was describing a mythical hero, and he gave a definition of a hero. When I heard that, immediately I knew that fits Schindler perfectly. And so it went something like this, paraphrased. A hero is an ordinary human being who does the best of things in the worst of times. And that was Schindler. You know, even towards the end, he still had the same habit of coming down to the factory floor and visit with us, and sometimes he'd call me to his office and give me a little piece of bread that I would share with my father and my brother who worked in the same location. And he just did these kind of things, these kind of human things. Just one day, one night, working nights, and one night I was working, and he had his habit of coming to talk to me, and he'd ask me these normal things, how I'm doing and all that stuff, and what this piece was for. Then the next day, this time, I found out that Schindler left word that I should not be assigned to night work anymore. I should only work daytime. You know, this is something really, really extraordinary. I'm sure he didn't know that I was beginning to get blurry eyes every once in a while, working 12-hour shifts at night, and was hungry all the time, looking for food even there. And so I don't think he knew that, but he was just the kind of human being that instinctively he said, this kid shouldn't work nights all the time. And so he assigned me to daytime only, And I don't mind telling you, there was a little bit of jealousy in the rest of the group, you know, saying, hey, how come you have to, you work days and we have to work nights? I said, I don't know, Schindler's orders, you know, what can I say? So this is, now, and he did some other things that there are unusual, and that is, at the end of the war, just before the war ended, things got kind of loose, you know, the warehouses were not being guarded so much, and the Nazis were beginning to run for their lives, and so things were a little bit open. He got a truck with some people on it, and he went to one of those warehouses, and he brought back to the camp hundreds of bolts of cloth, all navy blue, and hundreds of bottles of vodka. And you know, and he ordered that after the war, everybody who leaves the camp should receive a bolt of cloth and a bottle of vodka. So the five of us, we had five bolts of cloth, five bottles of vodka. And you know, at the end of the war, it's not like the movie where everybody goes off singing Yerushalayim Shalav, you know, and the movie changes from black and white to color, and it's always all very happy. It wasn't. That's not how it happened. Just in the movie, did. But in real life, we were traumatized. We didn't know what to do. We didn't have any place to go. The only thing we knew is that we came from Krakow. So when they offered us a trip back to Krakow, we went. So we all went to Krakow, and you know, it wasn't long before we realized that that was not a good thing. We were not, you know, to say the least, people were not happy with having a few of us survivors come back. And so my sister and my brother went to back to Czechoslovakia, and I did too, and tried to figure out maybe we could settle in Czechoslovakia instead. And that wasn't too good. In the meantime, my mother insisted that I should come back because, you know, she lost everybody, now no children at all, and so she wanted to at least have one. And that was me. I was the youngest one, so she insisted at least have one. So my brother and my sister went to Israel. They went there in 1948. And we escaped from Poland in 1946, a year after we came. We came in 45 after the war, and in 46 we escaped. I'm being punished for all those jokes. Yeah. And so we escaped from Poland and ended up, and my parents and I ended up in a displaced persons camp for the next 3 years. And in the meantime, my mother had a brother and a sister who came to this country in the early 1900s. And they knew what happened to their families, so they assumed that everybody had died. And then one day they discovered there were three people in this displaced persons camp that was could be related to them. So they wrote to us and we wrote to them, and of course it was my mother's sister and brother who brought us to this country and took till 1949. So in 1949, the three of us came to this country where there was not a word of English among us, and started a whole new life. But I want to tell you, when I came to this country, the minute I stepped in Boston where we landed, I knew I was in a different world altogether, in a different kind of country, a different kind of people. People here are generous, friendly, helpful. That's right. I just knew it when I first stepped on here. And it's been like that the rest of the time. You know, it was always, I was always received help, and people were always willing to help, and I'm going to tell you this. This is sort of minor, but we were given money to take a train from Boston to Los Angeles because that's where our relatives lived. So gave us money for food. It took 3 days. So we'd go to the railroad cars and, you know, to the dining car and ask for something. We didn't know how to say it, so we just point to something, and they'd give us some of this food and tell us how much it was. And I was the cashier, so I would take out a large bill and give it to them. They'd give me change. Next time I did that, I took out a large bill and they gave me change. I was too embarrassed to know. I didn't know what they were saying. So I had a large pocket full of change sitting there, you know, looking at the change, looking at the coins in the train. And a woman came up and sat not too far from us, and she knew we were foreigners, you know, we were really foreigners. We talked a foreign language and everything, and look, we dressed like that and everything. And she came over to me and took a coin out of my hand and said, "No, this is a nickel, and put it back. This is a dime, and put it back," and so on. You know, all the coins. She told me the names of the coins, and I learned the names of the coins. And then when she finished, she got up and left. That's it. That's all she did. A very small kindness, you know, that I experienced, and it's something. It's something I remembered for over 60 years. So little kindness goes a long way, you know. We can all put together a bunch of kindnesses, and we'll have a better world. I'm going to have to leave you here and give you a break. And I want to thank you very much for listening to me and watching me blow my nose. That was not in the script, and I thank you again. It was just an extra. And thanks for coming.
Thank you.
So you don't take questions from the audience?
I do. I do. Oh, well. Man, I don't even know what people are doing for.
It's not quite as good as vodka, but.
Yeah, okay. That's very good. I do, by the way, I do take questions, I'd be very happy to answer them if you're willing to stay a little longer in this heat and watching me blow my nose. You're going to use that? Okay. Okay, fine. There's one man right here.
Did you ever meet up with the Schindlers again after you left Czechoslovakia? Tell me anything you can about Mrs. Schindler and what became of them.
Well, Mrs. Schindler was quite helpful, too. Speaking to answer your question about Mrs. Schindler, Emily Schindler was quite helpful to Schindler in the camps and in the company, but she worked behind the scenes. And she had started an infirmary for those people who were not well, and she did all kinds of work like that. But because Schindler being such an overwhelming kind of personality, it kind of got lost in the shuffle, but she deserves a lot of credit too. And she, by the way, she's the only one that has a right to complain about Schindler. And then Schindler did come. He came to Los Angeles in 1965. By that time, I was already in this country. You know, I grew. I was as tall as he was. He came to Los Angeles to visit us. There were quite a few survivors from Schindler's List who were there. And when it was my turn to greet him, I thought maybe I should introduce myself because I grew. You know, last time he saw me, I was 16, and I was, you know, little. So he interrupted me anyway and said, "Yeah, I know who you are. You're a little Leyson." He knew me from 20 years later. Yeah.
I have a question. Why wasn't, since you were working in his factory, couldn't you get more food for him?
Well, he could get more food for us in Krakow. But in Brindlitz, in the last location where we were, he was not able to get as much. So the soup got thinner, the rations got smaller, and we were running out of steam.
Did he use the money instead to save more souls?
Absolutely. Yeah. There was even, you know, it's not well known, but there was a train that stopped on the, that was being transported. There were Jewish prisoners being transported from one camp to another, and it was winter time, and they abandoned the train. They just abandoned it. And it was near where our camp was, Schindler's camp in Czechoslovakia. And they, so they, he sent some people out there, and they opened the railroad cars, and there were people frozen and then down to the floor, and many of them were dead. And some who were alive, they brought them into the camp and nourished them. Some of them survived.
You said you hadn't told your story for 40-some years. What made you decide to tell it? Was it the movie? And
the movie, yeah, basically the movie. I started, after the movie came out, there was so much interest in this Schindler story and the Holocaust, and I was asked to give an interview. And after several weeks of thinking about it.
Two questions. Could you tell us whatever happened to your parents? And also, I know that you saw Schindler in 65. Did you keep in touch, and how did he come to be buried in Israel?
He requested that. He requested that he be buried in Israel. He used to travel to Israel often. He used to visit his the people who were on his list. He called us his children. He went to visit his children. And he requested to be buried in the Israelites. That's how. Yes, sir.
Did you ever have a sense that Schindler had help in saving you all?
Help?
Help.
Well, he had help from these Nazis who he bribed, yes. But other than that, there wasn't any, there was no Schindler like Schindler. There were some people like him. You know, I must admit that, you know, one of the things that, one of the benefits from the movie, when Schindler's List came out, and Schindler was presented and everybody discovered about this rescuer, this fantastic man, besides the fact that he had saved 1,200 people, is that some people who were rescuers were willing to come out and admit they had been rescuers. You know what I mean? You know, some of these people were hiding the fact that they were rescuing Jews. And so when this came out, they felt freer to go ahead and admit they had rescued. So many, many rescuers who rescued Jews from 2, 3 at a time, 4 at a time, you know, came out and admitted. Extra best. Yes?
During this period, did you ever lose faith in God?
No. It doesn't work that way, you know. I know they say that there are no atheists in fossils. Yeah. And so, yeah, I was pulling for him really hard. Yeah. Do it. I heard about it, and we talked about it, but I was not instrumental in getting the book written or having the movie made. A friend of mine I didn't remember him because he was a little older than I, who was responsible for that, remembered me. And, he was the kind of man who insisted on having the book written. Kept pestering people and finally having it. And then pestering Spielberg for 10 years until Spielberg got it. But Spielberg said that he wasn't ready. He had to, you know, get ready to be able to make a film like that. And even during the filming, he had to stop. He couldn't do it. It was too hard. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was going to ask, are there scenes in the movie, I don't remember the connection, are there scenes in the movie that portray incidents with you, and if so, did you find them realistic or accurate?
Are the scenes in the movie
portraying incidents with you, and if so, did you find them accurate?
Pretty much. A little movie life, you know, a little movie life. My experiences with Schindler were more human-like rather than movie-like. You know, really on a human level, you know, this person would come up and this man who came, you know, making a fortune in Poland, and the big Nazi came and spoke to me in complete sentences and, you know, kind of treated me as a human being. That's really special.
Were you able to celebrate Shabbat or Yom Tov when you were in the...
Yeah, that's right. You know, we did all those things that we could behind our backs. We prayed, and we did, you know, like I said, we had a painter, we sang songs and did all these things.